Beneath the calm turquoise waters of the Caribbean Sea, there might be something powerful that could change Jamaica forever. Not gold, not diamonds, but oil, billions of barrels of it, according to some estimates hidden under layers of ancient seabed rock. If that's true, Jamaica could be sitting on the kind of discovery that transformed Guyana from one of South America's poorest countries into an oil powerhouse almost overnight. But this isn't just a story about oil. It's about possibility, risk, and the choices that will define Jamaica's future. Because every barrel of oil comes with a question: will it bring prosperity or problems? This is the story of the Walton-Morant license, Jamaica's best hope and biggest gamble in the search for black gold. Jamaica runs on imported energy. Every drop of oil, every gallon of gasoline, every cubic foot of natural gas that powers our vehicles, our factories, our homes come from somewhere else, and that dependence comes at a price. When global oil prices rise, Jamaica feels it immediately in higher electricity bills, increased transport costs, and inflated prices for goods. It's not just an economic issue, it's a national security issue. Because when your energy comes from overseas, your economy depends on forces you can't control. Wars, sanctions, supply disruptions, even pandemics. That's why energy security is economic security. And right now, Jamaica doesn't have it. So, imagine the alternative Jamaica that finds oil. A Jamaica that produces enough to power its economy and sell the surplus. A Jamaica where fuel prices are stable, where revenue from oil funds schools, hospitals, highways, and housing. That dream is what drives the excitement behind the Walton-Morant license. But between dream and reality lies a gulf of uncertainty, one filled with science, politics, money, and risk. The Walton-Morant license covers a massive section of Jamaica's offshore waters, around 22,400 square kilometers of seabed. That's almost the same size as the island itself. It includes two deep geological basins, the Walton Basin in the west and the Morant Basin in the east. These are regions of ancient rock formations that may have trapped oil and gas millions of years ago. The area ranges from shallow waters of 50 meters to deep waters over 2,000 meters. This is where geologists believe the next big story of Jamaica's energy future might be written. The license is currently held by United Oil and Gas PLC, a UK-based energy company listed on the London Stock Exchange. They entered the picture in 2017 as a junior partner with Tullow Oil, the same company that struck oil in Guyana. But after a corporate restructuring in 2020, Tullow exited Jamaica, and United took full control. Fast forward to March 2025, the Jamaican government grants United a two-year license extension to January 31, 2028. That decision came 10 months before the old license was due to expire, signaling clear government support and political will to see the project continue. But extensions don't produce oil. For that, United needs what every small explorer eventually needs: a deep-pocketed partner. So, what's in this block that's causing such excitement? United Oil and Gas has identified over 40 exploration leads and 21 potential prospects. According to Gaffney Klein and Associates, a leading global energy consultancy, the high-graded prospects hold an unrisked prospective resource of 2.4 billion barrels. United's internal data goes even further, suggesting the area could hold up to 7 billion barrels of oil. To put that in context, Guyana's Stabroek Block, the discovery that changed everything, contains around 11 billion barrels. So, if Jamaica's estimates even partially hold true, we're talking about a discovery that could rank among the biggest in the region. But remember, those numbers are unrisked. That means they assume everything goes right, that the oil is there, that it's trapped, that it can be extracted economically. In reality, only a fraction of those estimates usually prove viable, if any. That's why no one is popping champagne yet. Because despite all the excitement, not a single well has been drilled in the Walton-Morant block. So, what has been done? United has spent years collecting and analyzing geological data. They've conducted seismic surveys both 2D and 3D to map what lies beneath the seafloor. In total, they've gathered over 2,200 square kilometers of 3D seismic data, which uses sound waves to create underground maps showing potential oil traps. Then in June 2025, Jamaica's National Environment and Planning Agency, NEPA, granted United an environmental permit to conduct a piston core survey, a process where sediment samples are collected from the seabed to test for hydrocarbons. In simple terms, it's a way to find out if oil is naturally leaking up through the rocks, a major clue that larger reserves may exist below. By September 2025, United received its final operational permit, meaning they're cleared to begin taking those core samples. That's a big step, but it's still early-stage exploration data collection, not drilling. The company is also reprocessing its seismic data to enhance imaging quality, integrate seabed mapping, and pinpoint the best possible drilling targets. All of this work is about one thing: reducing risk before anyone spends tens of millions of dollars on a well that might come up dry. Exploration wells aren't cheap. In offshore areas like this, one well can cost $30 million or more. And because the Walton-Morant area is considered frontier territory, the odds of finding commercial oil on the first try are low. United Oil and Gas simply doesn't have that kind of capital. So, they've been searching for what's called a farm-in partner, a larger oil company willing to fund part of the drilling in exchange for a share of any potential find. As of mid-2025, United said multiple potential partners were under non-disclosure agreements, reviewing the data in their virtual data room. But after years of searching, none have signed on. That tells you something about the perceived risk. If this project were a sure thing, the majors Exxon, Chevron, BP would have been lining up already. Their caution doesn't mean there's no oil, but it does mean the geology is uncertain, and the risk-to-reward ratio is high. Jamaica's search for oil isn't new. Between 1955 and 1983, 11 wells were drilled across the island, both onshore and offshore. 10 of them showed traces of oil or gas. Not one found commercial quantities. The old wells were drilled using outdated data and equipment, often in the wrong geological formations. But they proved something important: the ingredients for oil, the source rocks, the traps, the reservoirs are present in Jamaica. Fast forward to the 2010s, and Tullow Oil reignited exploration interest. In 2017, they discovered live oil seeps near Pedro Bank, meaning oil was actively leaking from underground, not ancient residue. It was physical, modern proof that oil systems existed beneath Jamaica's waters. But by 2020, Tullow pulled out, unable to justify further spending in a volatile global market. Since then, United Oil and Gas has kept the flame alive, conducting the studies, holding the license, and pushing forward cautiously. To understand Jamaica's dream, you have to understand Guyana's miracle. In 2015, ExxonMobil drilled the Liza-1 well in Guyana's Stabroek Block, a well it rated as having only a 20% chance of success. They struck a world-class discovery, more than 295 feet of oil-bearing sandstone. That single find changed everything. Within 4 years, Guyana was producing oil. By 2019, Exxon and its partners had made over 30 discoveries in the same region. Production has now surpassed 600,000 barrels per day, and Guyana's GDP grew by over 62% in 2022, the highest in the world. But ExxonMobil spent hundreds of millions to get there. And it took world-class technology, expertise, and crucially luck. That's the lesson for Jamaica. Oil discoveries require capital, persistence, and patience. And even then, the outcome is never guaranteed. Every oil story has its dark side. Environmental risk. Jamaica's economy thrives on tourism and fishing, both depend on clean, beautiful waters. Pedro Bank, part of the exploration area is Jamaica's main fishing ground. A single oil spill could devastate coral reefs, marine life, and livelihoods. Economic risk, the resource curse. History shows that oil wealth can corrupt economies. If mismanaged, it fuels inequality, weakens other industries, and breeds corruption. Guyana, despite its success, is already debating how oil wealth should be managed, who benefits and who doesn't. For Jamaica, that means one thing. If oil is found, governance must be airtight. Transparent royalty agreements. Fair taxes. Local content laws ensuring Jamaicans get the jobs. Global risk, the energy transition. The world is moving toward renewables. Even if Jamaica found oil tomorrow, it could take 7 to 10 years to begin production. By then, demand for oil may decline as electric vehicles and green energy expand. United Oil argues that Jamaica's project could still fit into a low-carbon future because the area's shallow waters reduce emissions during drilling, but the economics depend entirely on global prices. As of late 2025, United Oil and Gas stands at a crossroads. The next milestone is the piston core survey, collecting up to 60 sediment samples from the seabed. If these samples show strong evidence of oil seepage, it could finally attract a partner ready to drill. If not, the project might stall or end entirely. Meanwhile, United continues to reprocess seismic data and fine-tune its geological models. Everything is geared toward reducing risk and convincing investors the odds are worth taking. The license now runs until January 2028. If no well is drilled by then, the government faces a choice: extend again or let it lapse. Imagine the best-case scenario. The piston core survey succeeds, a major partner signs on, and the first well strikes oil. What then? Jamaica could see billions in government revenue through royalties and taxes. Thousands of jobs could emerge not only on rigs, but across logistics, transport, engineering, law, and marine services. The Jamaican dollar could strengthen. Energy imports would drop. The country could even become a net exporter. But these benefits depend entirely on smart management. Jamaica would need to negotiate strong production sharing agreements. Establish a sovereign wealth fund for future generations. Ensure local participation in the industry. Enforce strict environmental standards to protect tourism and fisheries. Because oil can build nations or break them. And that brings us to the hardest question of all: should we even pursue oil in the first place? Jamaica is one of the countries most vulnerable to climate change. Rising seas, stronger hurricanes, and coral bleaching threaten our very survival. So how do we justify drilling for oil when we're already feeling the effects of fossil fuels? Some argue that Jamaica should leave the oil untouched, a bold statement in favor of global climate responsibility. Others counter that developing nations have the right to use their own resources to build their economies, especially when rich nations made their fortunes burning fossil fuels. Perhaps the middle path is this: use oil to fund a clean energy future. If we find oil, invest the revenue in solar, wind, and green technology so we can transition away from it. Oil should be Jamaica's stepping stone, not its foundation. Over the next few years, watch these five key milestones. 1. The piston core results, the first real test of whether hydrocarbons are present. 2. Farm in partner announcement, the make or break moment for drilling. 3. Government framework, new policies on royalties, taxes, and local content. 4. Public transparency, environmental impact assessments and open consultation. 5. The 2028 deadline. Will the license be extended again, or finally expire? So, can Jamaica become an oil-producing nation? Maybe, but it won't be easy, and it won't happen soon. History says most frontier projects never reach production. But even a small discovery could change Jamaica's trajectory. We should explore but cautiously, transparently, and with our eyes open. Oil should never replace our investment in renewables, it should finance it. The Walton-Morant license is more than a search for oil. It's a mirror reflecting Jamaica's greatest ambitions and its greatest tests. If we manage this wisely, we could achieve energy independence, economic strength, and resilience. If we mismanage it, we could sacrifice our environment and stability for short-term gain. This story isn't finished. The next chapter depends on science, leadership, and wisdom. So, what do you think? Should Jamaica pursue offshore oil? Or should we leave it beneath the sea and focus entirely on renewable energy? Let's talk in the comments. If you found this deep dive valuable, please like, subscribe, and hit the bell so you don't miss the next video into Jamaica's economy and development. Until next time, stay curious, stay informed, and keep asking the hard questions about where Jamaica is headed.